tao na lilipat po dito sa atin para hindi na po makadagdag po dun sa ano, sa issue na kinakaharap po ng unit namin ngayon.
Over now to the ongoing onion crisis in the Philippines, Senate Minority Leader Coco Pimentel says the issue highlights the importance of appointing a full-time agriculture secretary. He says the Agriculture Department failed to recognize the lack of supply and came out too late with the order to import. This has led to a spike in prices reaching as high as 700 pesos per kilo. The Department of Agriculture is concurrently headed by President Marcos.
Because the Agriculture Secretary is the President of the Republic with so many other issues, this has been delegated to a USEC and to a division head. For example, now, they are making the decision to import now. February 15 is the harvest season. Okay. Ang tanong, during the lean months, yung non-harvest time, months before Christmas, which is the peak season for consumption, they did not make the same decision to import. Question is why? Alam na dapat nila that these are lean months, but the world supply is there, but they did not allow importation.
So who's
wrong timing?
Filipino consumers may soon enjoy refined sugar at a lower cost. Sugar Regulatory Administrator David Alba will recommend selling seized smuggled sugar in government's Kadiwa stores. Alba says he will suggest the move to President Marcos. The Customs Bureau on Saturday seized 4,000 metric tons of smuggled white refined sugar from a vessel that docked at the port of Batangas.
Malacanang bears three new government appointees. President Marcos has tapped Romulo Arugay to head the Commission on Filipinos Overseas. The commission is tasked to provide assistance to the President and Congress in the formulation of policies concerning Filipinos overseas. He has also appointed Mario Molina as an acting member of the Board of Trustees in the GSIS. And lastly, Joan Padilla has been appointed as the Intramuros Administrator under the Department of Tourism.
The province of Northern Samar placed under a state of calamity due to the devastation caused by the recent floods and landslides there. Over 238,000 individuals were affected by the bad weather. Damage to infrastructure and agriculture has been pegged at 683 million pesos. Among the hardest hit were the municipalities of Catarman, Catubig, and Las Navas. The Provincial Disaster Office expects recovery to take up to a year.
For early recovery, that's around 1 to 3 months, ano, yung lalong-lalo na yung agriculture. Dahil hindi naman to bagyo, no, na nagpatumba nung mga yung namin, no. So more on pala ito. So once we recover, we will be able to replant or resupply our farmers with seeds, no? Kahit pa paano yung early recovery andyan na. Pero yung mga damage sa infra, no? Kaya sinet ng aming local sangguniang panlalawigan, no? Yung sangguniang panlalawigan namin sa declaration ng state of calamity, they put a period of maximum of 1 year for the recovery.
Let's now check on the weather here in the Philippines with Pagasa forecaster Dan Villamil. Dan?
Good afternoon. As of the moment, we are monitoring two low pressure areas inside the Philippine area of responsibility. The first low pressure area was estimated on all available data in the vicinity of Homonhon Island, Eastern Samar. Meanwhile, another low pressure area was located at 330 kilometers west of Puerto Princesa City, Palawan. These low pressure areas, the possibility of these low pressure areas becoming tropical cyclones in the next 24 hours remain low. So as of the moment, the combined effects of the low pressure area and shoreline will bring cloudy skies with scattered rain showers and thunderstorms over Surigao del Norte, Dinagat Islands, Eastern Visayas, Bicol Region, Quezon, and Kalayaan Islands. Meanwhile, due to the effects of the northeast monsoon, we'll also expect cloudy skies with rains over Apayao, Cagayan Valley, and Aurora. here in Metro Manila and the rest of Luzon, we're expecting partly cloudy to cloudy skies with chances of light rains due to the effects of the northeast monsoon. And for the rest of the country, particularly in the rest of Visayas and the whole of Mindanao, we would expect generally fair weather conditions. But this afternoon up until the evening, we would expect chances of localized thunderstorms. Temperature range for Metro Manila for tomorrow will be from 24 to 29 degrees Celsius, 16 to 22 degrees for Baguio City, and 24 to 28 degrees Celsius for Legazpi City. For our sea condition, there is a gale warning currently issued over the seaboards of Batanes, Cagayan, Mabuyan Islands, Ilocos Norte, Ilocos Sur, La Union, Pangasinan, Isabela, Aurora, Northern Quezon, Camarines Norte, Northern Coast of Camarines Sur, Northern and Eastern Coast of Catanduanes and Kalayaan Islands. Fishing boats and other small sea craft are advised not to venture out into the sea, while larger sea vessels are alerted against big waves. That will be all for the weather report for today. Dan Villamil reporting.
Thanks, Dan.
Two development workers who were reported missing last week have been found. Diane Gumanao and Armand Dayoha were fetched by their families at a resort in Carmen, Cebu, Monday. Gumanao's father says the two were abducted shortly after they arrived in Cebu from Cagayan de Oro, where they spent the holidays. Cell phone footage released by human rights group Karapatan showed a supposed commotion at the port.
Patuloy yung pananawagan namin sa publiko na yung lalo na yung mga naka-witness na kakuha ng mga photos, videos na kung pwede ipadala sa amin na para madadagan yung mga ebidensya namin sa pangyayari na yun.
Ako gusto ko nga balikan yung police doon, yung nag-investigate sa amin, kasi sabi niya wala. Tapos ngayon nakikita namin sa video, hindi yun maari. Dapat sasagutin nila lahat kung anong ginagawa nila.
And to the two victims to cooperate with the investigation because their statements will be very indispensable in the filing of charges.
Rights group Karapatan now looking at several legal options to bring the alleged abductors to justice. Karapatan Central Visayas spokesperson Dennis Abarientos said they are not only going after the perpetrators, but also different government offices, which they accuse of inaction.
We are confident na we'll be able to file yung mga appropriate charges. Hindi lang doon sa actual na pagdukot na medyo matatagalan tayo, pero yung mismong inaction na on the part ng mga government authorities sa port, sa port office, sa PNP, sa maritime at sa kung andan pa. The complaint was filed in different police stations. Mm-hmm. Since Friday until now, wala pa ring in result ang investigation.
Meanwhile, Bayan Secretary General Renato Reyes urges the government to speak out on the reported abductions. In a statement, Reyes said, staying mum on the matter will allow impunity to continue.
Up next, Italy's most wanted fugitive finally caught after 30 years.
And a survey shows majority of world economists expect a global recession this year. More news when we return.
To watching Top Story, here again are the headlines. The Philippine economy is expected to grow by 6.5% this year.
98% of high-ranking police officials have submitted their courtesy resignations amid the Philippine government's campaign to cleanse the ranks.
Filipino fishermen still not free to enter the West Philippine Sea despite President Marcos's pronouncement that China had agreed to not prevent local fisherfolk from going to traditional fishing grounds.
And China's population shrinks for the first time in 60 years.
Dozens of individuals are charged in Brazil over the January 8th riots in the country's capital. Brazil's public prosecutor put forward the charges on Monday for armed criminal association, violence, and coup-mongering against 39 individuals. That number is a small fraction from the more than 1,000 supporters of former President Jair Bolsonaro, who stormed the government complex in Brasilia. Bolsonaro, who remains in the U.S., has been included in the investigation. He previously denounced the unrest and denied involvement in inciting the riots. Authorities have since ramped up security in the capital amid threats of new protests by Bolsonaro supporters.
Indonesia opens a trial on five individuals over their alleged roles in last year's soccer stadium stampede that left 135 people dead. A court began its hearing on Monday against three policemen and two match officials who were charged with negligence over the incident. They each face a maximum jail term of 5 years if convicted. The October 2022 tragedy unfolded after police fired tear gas inside a stadium in East Java's Malang City. That triggered panic among soccer fans in the venue, eventually leading into a stampede. State investigators have concluded the excessive use of tear gas was the main cause of the crush. It is considered as among the world's worst sporting disasters.
Six people are killed after two gunmen opened fire at a home in Tulare County in California. Police said the victims include a six-month-old baby and its 17-year-old mother. Two people survived the assault. Authorities say the attack may be targeted and may be linked to gang and drug violence. Police conducted a drug-related search at that same home last week. The two assailants remain at large.
Italy's most wanted fugitive finally caught after a 30-year manhunt. 60-year-old Messina Denaro was known as a triggerman and a leading figure of the Sicilian crime syndicate. He was arrested at a health facility where he is seeking treatment using a different name. The prime minister calls the arrest a great victory for the state's war against organized crime. Denaro has been accused of multiple murders. He is also suspected to have been behind several bombing incidents in 1993.
The latest on a tragic plane crash in Nepal, the black boxes of the doomed flight have been recovered. Data from the cockpit voice and flight data recorders are crucial to determining what caused the Yeti Airlines plane to go down despite clear skies. The disaster killed at least 70 individuals. Two other passengers are still unaccounted for. Nepal's aviation officials have said all units of that aircraft in the country had no technical faults prior to the tragedy.
China's population falls for the first time in six decades. It shrank from 1.412 billion in 2021 to 1.411 billion at the end of 2022. Last year's birth rate was 6.77 births per 1,000 people. That's the lowest on record. At the same time, China's death rate was at its highest since 1976, mainly due to the pandemic. Much of the demographic downturn is the result of China's one-child policy imposed between 1980 and 2015, as well as the high cost of living. The decline in China's population now paves the way for India to become the world's most populous nation this year.
The three-day rally of the Philippine Stock Exchange fizzles out. Downbeat trading also seen across the rest of Asia as investors digest economic data out of China. Michelle Long reports.
The global rally stalling on a slowing Chinese economy and ahead of the Bank of Japan policy decision. Asian stocks edged lower for a second day after data showed China's economy grew at its second slowest pace since the 1970s as its economy got whacked by strict COVID restrictions last year. But there's a silver lining. Better than expected fourth quarter and December economic data hinting China may be ready for a recovery. HSBC's Fan Chuk Wan expecting Asian markets to outperform this year, primarily driven by China's reopening.
Currently, we are most bullish on China and Hong Kong, given the catalyst from the full reopening and policy stimulus to stabilize the housing market in China. But we also see opportunities in the ASEAN regions. At the moment, we are overweight on Indonesia and Thailand, given these two markets are still leading the earnings momentum within Southeast Asia.
HSBC is, however, neutral on Philippine equities, which has already corrected substantially last year, with a price-to-earnings ratio of 12.6 times, below historical average. Plus, on expectations, growth will decelerate this year from last year's high base. HSBC is pricing in another 75 basis point hike by the Banco Central, taking the policy benchmark to 6.25% this year. For the day, the PSE index back in the red, wiping out 0.5% or 31 points, dragging the index back to 70.14.
I think the run-up of 7.5%, and you may add the run-up from the fourth quarter, which boils about 22% already, is quite too soon.
AIA Philippines' Jing Candelaria is cautiously optimistic. He thinks 2023 will be a tale of two halves.
First will be quite a difficult market where interest rates are still expected to go up in the U.S., which is the focal point of global interest rates, which is still not supportive of risk assets. Now, the second leg will be after the inflection point, or what we could say the pivot, where the U.S. Fed would say, okay, this is enough. We've done damage already to the U.S. economy. We've brought it down. We've tempered it down. And therefore, it may be time to temper or even reverse our interest rate policy to bring it up. And therefore, that becomes more supportive of risk assets. And we expect this to happen more towards the end of the year.
Well, Harold Tan, market trader and author of Earning Your First Million in Stocks, sees the bulls taking over by third quarter.
This third quarter, this year, the earliest, and the bulls might continue to roll over until year 2024. There are a lot of factors that create an exuberant market that we are experiencing today, such as the lowered food prices, which are big issues last year. Mm-hmm. The currency level that we are having right now is trading at around 54. The lowered income taxes, which added more discretionary income to the middle income earner classes, that affects the bottom line.
In corporate stories, the T-led GT Capital Holdings confirms it is interested and open to discuss opportunities in raising its stake in infrastructure conglomerate Metro Pacific Investments from the current 15.6%. It, however, clarifies there are no definitive agreements yet. Earlier this month, rumors were rife Japan's Mitsui is looking to buy a 20% stake in the Manny Pangilinan-led MPIC. Meanwhile, Century Peak Holdings says it is one step closer to launching its cement brand to the market after getting the DTI's quality standard certification. The mining firm says its evolution to include cement manufacturing is a natural progression, translating limestone to another revenue-generating endeavor, cement, which will benefit from the government's Build Better More program. Its plant located in Cebu has a capacity of 1 million tons of cement annually, providing jobs to almost 200 people. In other news, BPI shareholders give the go signal to the Ayala-led bank's proposed merger with the Gokong Waste Robinsons Bank, with BPI as the surviving entity. BPI says merging with Robinsons Bank, whose consumer loans account for 42% of loan mix, will help it increase its consumer loans to 30% of total loan book. It will also provide opportunities for BPI to collaborate across the Gokong Waste Group's ecosystem, which includes food manufacturing, air transportation, real estate and retail, plus its strong presence in the Filipino-Chinese market segment. Post-merger, the Gokong Waste family will end up with a little over 10% of BPI, becoming the second biggest stockholder of the bank after the Zabel family. And finally, it's confirmed Citicor Renewable Energy Corporation, or CREC, the sponsor company of Citicor Energy REIT, or C-REIT, is considering going public this year. CREC has not revealed the size of the offering, but called it blockbuster, with proceeds to accelerate its renewable energy projects. C-REC is part of the Megawide Group headed by Ed Saavedra. Michelle Long, ABS-CBN News.
A survey by the World Economic Forum shows nearly two-thirds of leading world economists expect a worldwide recession this year. The WEF managing director notes high inflation, low growth, high debt, and high fragmentation environment reduce incentives for investments needed to get back to growth and raise living standards for the world's most vulnerable.
The ASEAN Plus 3 Macroeconomic Research Office, or AMRO, lowers its short-term growth forecast for the region. From its October forecast of 3.7%, AMRO now expects the region's economy to grow by 3.3% in 2022. AMRO cites a continuing weakness in these economies, particularly in China. But for this year, the research office projects a 4.3% growth in the ASEAN Plus 3 region. AMRO also updated its outlook for the Philippines. It slightly lowered its GDP forecast for Manila from 6.3% to 6.2%. As for inflation, it expects consumer prices in the country to rise at a faster pace of 4.3% due to the lack of subsidies to control prices. Despite this, AMRO's chief economist still expects the Philippines to remain a bright spot in the region after proving its resilience against higher policy rates and elevated borrowing costs.
And before we go, newly crowned Miss Universe Arbony Gabriel reveals her lucky charm at the pageant. Let's find out more from Mari Dumawal.
Our new Miss Universe!
On their first stage together after her coronation, Miss Universe Arbony Gabriel and new Miss Universe franchise owner Anja Klachutatip hit it off with their fashion exchange. They have a common denominator, Filipino designer Rian Fernandez, who crafted Gabriel's fabulous gowns in the pageant and one of Anne's stunning evening wear.
Look at the dress and the crown. She's so ready to match up everything.
I did it for you. I saw the crown was blue, so I added the blue last minute.
This is why you are a transformational leader. Because you have vision, you are visionary.
A native of Alcalá, Pangasinan, Fernandez is regarded as Gabriel's lucky charm. He has a long record of designing gowns of Filipina and international beauty queens, as well as showbiz personalities like SB19. In 2019, he was introduced by a Miss Universe makeup artist to Gabriel. Since then, Fernandez made her gowns for Miss Texas and Miss USA until her triumph as Miss Universe over the weekend. He hailed Gabrielle as a unique fashion collaborator since she herself is a designer. They shared a vision of creating the much-talked-about edgy black-blue gown studded with crystals, which is a far departure from usual pageant gowns.
The best quality that I like with Arbony is her vision. She knows what she wants, but it's a very challenging task for me to put all her visions together. Because the materials, from materials to the style, it's so challenging because it's new to the pageantry world.
Me, when I'm picking out a gown, I want some sort of drama or something unexpected. I'm always experimenting as well. I would encourage women to be curious and experiment with things. When you wear something, you transform and you feel confident in it.
Fernandez also revealed that they purposely matched the color use of the gown with the new Miss Universe crown.
I still cannot believe that. I know from the very start that Arbony will be the next Miss Universe because we worked together ever since she competed in Miss Texas. We break the norm in order for us to portray a very empowered woman of today.
Fernandez and Gabriel also have the same advocacy in employing and teaching skills to marginalized women in the fashion industry. Since 2018, Fernandez had been helping mothers, employing them in his shops in Pangasinan.
My world just got turned upside down, but I absolutely would love to visit the Philippines. I was speaking with a friend a couple months ago that's in the Philippines. He's a designer. And I told him I would love to set up some sewing workshops and teach little girls how to sew.
Above all, Fernandez regards Gabriel's victory as another triumph of Filipino creativity on the global stage. The more exciting part is still coming with the preparations of Fernandez and Gabriel's other Filipino designer, Patrick Isorena, for her forthcoming visit in Manila to push her fashion advocacy. Mario Dumawal, ABS-CBN News.
And those were the top stories today. I'm Denise Tinsan.
And I'm Ron Crows. You can watch exclusive content and highlights and recaps of our shows online. Thanks for watching.